didn't take long for people to get confused. We're doing the Ramban at the end of Bo, and it didn't take long for people to get confused about their philosophical beliefs. Mehem Ko from Be'ikr, there are people who just deny God completely, right? I'm sure we all know, although we know there are no atheists in foxholes. I've met a lot of, kids and a lot of people over the years who, they'll say, oh, I don't believe in God. I don't know. Prove it to me, this and that. And they use different, and a lot of times when things get a little bit challenging, all of a sudden they start praying and they start believing in HaKadosh Baruch Hu. But the point is, there are certainly people who are kaif from Be'ikr. They deny the very essence of God. That's their philosophy. Va'omrim ke'olam kadmo. And they say, the world was always here. One of the fundamental beliefs of atheism before, I don't know exactly the time, and maybe our science experts here at Valley Torah, the boys who learned science at Valley Torah can tell me, when did Einstein, I think it was Einstein who proved that the universe is expanding? It's something that definitely in the last, 20, 50 years or so, maybe a little bit more, science proved the Earth is expanding. The universe, is expanding. When you prove the universe is expanding, what that proves is exactly what the Ramban says was the belief of many people. If the universe is expanding, that means there was a starting point and there was a push of energy outward that created the universe. Now, if you don't want to believe, you can say it's a Big Bang, which we don't know how the Big Bang started. But the prevailing belief before this scientific discovery was the world was always here. I don't have to tell you how the world got here. The world was always here. Don't ask, what do you mean always here? It can't always have been, and it has to start. No, there are people who believe that it was always here. Okay, and obviously we don't believe that. We believe God created the world. But it's very fascinating that that belief was completely debunked, even though it existed for thousands of years. That belief was debunked once it became clear that the universe is expanding. Because if the universe was always here, that means it's a stagnant situation. The minute you see firsthand, and it's there, you can I don't know the instruments, but the scientists have the instruments to prove and to show the world the universe is expanding. That clearly shows this is not true. As we know, it's not true. We knew before the instruments that it's not true. But that is one of the beliefs. Ki olam kadmon, the world was here from the very beginning. Okay. Kochshu b'Hashem v'yom elohu. They deny Kadosh Baruch Hu. They say, no God. This all happened by its own, one big accident, one big thing, whatever. Home Depot blew up. And all of the metals went up in the air, and they all came down, and this beautiful supercomputer that I have in my hand right now was actually created by all of the metals falling together, and that's how the supercomputer, now who would believe that? But, so that no one would believe. If I told you that this computer came about by an explosion at Home Depot, when all the bolts and the screws and the things from the shelves all came together, you'd say, I'm crazy, I need to get locked up with a straitjacket, but somehow to say that the world just got here by some big fancy gobbledygook of an explosion, that everyone seems to be comfortable with. But whatever, that's the way the world is. That's one type of belief. Okay, other people want to deny and say God does not know details. God is way too busy up there. He's got his NFL pass or NBA pass. I don't know what he's doing, but he's way too busy to be concerned with our little details here on earth. He's got his bigger things to worry about. So what does he care if I do this, I don't do that? It doesn't matter. Okay, he says, how in the world, how in the world can God know all the little details? He's all the way up there. He's somewhere far away. Okay, there are those who say, yeah, he does know, but he's not involved with details. God doesn't really care about what's going on. There's no reward or punishment. If I do good, if I do bad, it doesn't matter. They say God left the world. When you see that God intervenes in the natural order of things and creates miracles above and beyond the laws of nature, this nullifies everything. When you see God comes down and makes water into blood and puts frogs in the world and splits the sea and does all these incredible things, what this proves is God is here. and God is involved. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu did this during its Yetzias Mitzrayim. The parshas that we are reading now were done specifically to negate the notion that this is all either God never was involved. God isn't made the world, but he doesn't care about the world. God doesn't have the ability to be involved in this world. Any of these things are debunked by miracles. They indicate that there's a God that's making the world and he's renewing activities in the world. He knows, he's involved, and he can. Okay, and if, let's say, for example, Moshe Benu says, it's going to happen tomorrow morning at 10 a.m., it's going to happen, be ready, the hail is coming. Well, that just further adds, you also see the truth of the prophecy, that God speaks to man, and reveals his secrets to the prophets, and with that, it upholds the entire Torah. So this is a fundamental principle that what God did during this time and why, as we'll learn in a minute, why the Seder and all of these things, Zeich L'Tzias V'Tzrayim, it's not just because we love reminiscing about the good old days. It's not just about the good old days. It's about the fact that those good old days called Yetzias V'Tzrayim teach us some fundamental principles about the way God runs the world, and these are critical in our lives. And again, you know, different philosophies, but certainly even today, one can argue there are people, and we read books about people not such a long time ago. I'm not an expert in the great Tzaddik Abu Chatzer, but they say he was a Baal Mofes. They say what he did was incredible stuff. You can't explain it. Okay, we have the Ashkenazim have their Gedolim and their Gaonim of the previous generations. You know, the Baal Shem Tov was amazing. The Sfaradim, there are people in our history. You say there's no way that they did what they did without a special connection to upstairs. Now, if there's a special connection to upstairs, that means God is involved with downstairs, okay? If we're connecting the downstairs to the upstairs, that means God is here. And the truth of the matter is, Rav Yaakov Emden says something amazing. It was a great, great Gaon of about 250 years ago. And he says, greater than the miracle of the splitting of the sea, greater than all the miracles of going out of Egypt is the miracle of Jewish survival. The fact that we're here, Rabbi Isai, okay, when you think about all of the things that should explain that we should not be here. Now, Mark Twain said something similar, and when Mark Twain says it, everybody goes crazy and gets excited. You know, we have Rabbi Yaakov Emden said it 100 years before Mark Twain. But he also said, he wrote this famous essay, I'm sure you all read it, The Mystery of the Jew. He could not believe how the Jew is still here. And not only is the Jew still here, the Jew is at the cutting edge of all advancement, all of the great technological and scientific and medical advancements, there's a Jew. Everywhere you turn, they're like, percentage-wise, they're a speck of dust in the map of humanity. How much do the Jews represent a percentage of humanity? It's something. It's ridiculous. What, the 7 billion people? And they're like maybe 12 million Jews? You do the math. Okay, who has, Mr. Rogers, right? Honest math, right? You can figure it out. Okay, so you figure out what this 12 million compared to 7 billion, it's a joke. And yet, everywhere you turn, headlines every single day. Israel's in the headlines. How did this little Jewish state, right? This little, so people want to erase it from the map. What do you even care? It's like little nothing. It's like, it's the smallest thing that you can imagine. Yet, somehow, we're in the center of everything. Because HaKadosh Baruch Hu is involved with us. And the fact that we're still alive and still around and still here and thriving. And Israel is one of the most incredible countries in the world. And I just started, think about it. It started in 1948. This little country, okay, was desolate and abandoned. You just had a few Jews there. Now Jews all came to Eretz Yisrael. And look at what we're doing. The cutting edge of technology. How many companies, somebody once, I'm sure you read this somewhere, that everyone wants to do away with Israel. Rachman al-Tzlan, Chas v'Shalom. And and somebody said, be careful. If you do away with Israel, look at all the companies you're not going to have anymore that Israel is responsible for. So it's mind-boggling. It's mind-boggling. They're the center of everything. So of miracles, the greatest is the fact that we're still here. That's the greatest of the miracles. So therefore, the Ramban continues. Bottom paragraph on the right column. That's why we just read. in Shemos, I want you to know that I'm here. God did these miracles for a reason. It's not just a nice show. Okay, it isn't like a Broadway production. He wanted us to understand something. Lahoz al Ashkocha, to show that he's involved. Kilozav osol mikram kedaitam. It doesn't, there's no such thing as coincidences, okay? There's no such thing like that. And he said, I want you to know that our God is in the land. Lohos alachidush, to show us renewal. Hamachadesh betuvo b'choyom tamid ma'aseh v'reshis, right? We say that every single day. But even you guys say it, right? Hamachadesh betuvo, right? That's part of the davening. Right? Let's stop and think what we're saying. God renews the world every single day. So when we get up, we don't just say, Elokai, neshama shesatabi, because he renewed me, he gave me back my neshama. He literally, every second is renewing and giving power to the world to be. The minute HaKadosh Baruch Hu would remove that energy from the world, we'll go up, that's it, dust, you know, the space dust in 2 seconds. So, came shalom, because they are his, shaborah ma'ayin, he made them out of nothing. The Yamar. And furthermore, it says, I want you to understand that I am the one and only God. There are no other forces and no other powers in the world. And we have to remember that, because a lot of times we think, you know, the boss is going to give us a paycheck, and my brilliance is going to give us my, you know, my money, and I'm going to, you know, I'm the number one graduate, you know, in my class, and therefore I'm going to get a good job, and everything's going to be great. And, you know, I remember when we have these breakfasts for alumni, and one of the wealthier Jews in Los Angeles came and spoke. And this guy is, Baruch Hashem, a very, very wealthy fellow, very successful. And it was very important, he said, to about 40 guys, maybe 5, 6, 7 years older than you guys, already in college and in the business world, and some of them already professionals. And he said, the most important thing to remember in life is that it's all up to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. You think you're great in business, all of a sudden, you know, and when you're successful and your deals go, everyone thinks you're the biggest chacham. All of a sudden, a couple of years, you go down, no one talks to you anymore. Like, what happened? I lost my brains. What? Terrence is, it's all God, and when you're good, you're good. When God decides to take it away, chas v'shalom, then it's all up to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So if we have that recognition, he will respond to that. He feels it's an important thing. Obviously, he supports, and he's there for people who appreciate that, who understand that. Okay, Lohoros, we're about to go to the second column. Lohoros al yicholas shushol b'kol. He has shlita, God, over everything. There's nothing that can stop him. Because in all of these situations, the Egyptians did believe in God. What they didn't believe in is a God that was involved. And a lot of people have that mentality. I believe in God, but God doesn't really care about me. He doesn't really care about my life. He's not involved in my life. And that's a false notion. Or they're doubtful about it. So these miracles that God did for us in Egypt are the constant reminder of God's involvement in this world. Now, a lot of people have said, okay, so let's have it again. Okay, that was nice in the year 2448, but I want those miracles. Let God, you know, do this dog and pony show for me. Why not? So the Ramban says, no. It's not the way it goes. You can't just wake up and say, you know what, God, you know, there's a reason why God created a system. He did this once in the history of the world. He does other miracles that are more, obviously more hidden, that you have to look to. No one who remembers a six-day war will tell you it's not a miracle. There's no way to explain in 1968 how we were able to destroy all of these armies around us in the way we did it in 6 days. It's a mess. And it's on many different levels. The more you read about those 6 days, and really it's important to do, you'll see so many unique, specific stories. Like literally it was spooky, where they captured the Arabs and they asked the Arabs, I just remember one, but there are many, many hundreds of more amazing stories. And they said, they captured the Arabs, and they said, I understand. You had us surrounded, and you could have destroyed us. Why did you not just destroy us? You had us. So what do you mean, why did we destroy you? We were shooting at you, and then there was this man walking in front of you with a long white robe. And as we saw that he was deflecting the bullets or whatever, and we just said, and they came out like they all surrendered, didn't make any sense. The Jews didn't see any man with a white robe. There was no man with a white robe in reality there, but HaKadosh Baruch Hu created, and this many stories like this, literally inexplicable stories of how we defeated in these independent pockets of battles during those 6 days. Remarkable things. So he still does miracles, but it's hidden. It's, you know, you can argue if you want. So God doesn't do this dog and pony show every century or every thousand years, every millennia, no. He says, therefore, God does it once. He wants us to make a constant reminder of what we saw. Okay, that we should know, and we should testify, and we should internalize. And think about everybody. Say, therefore, every single thing that we do, so many things. And that we should give over these matters to our children. And their children to their children. Literally to the very end of the generations. Now think about it, because when you play a game, what's that game called when you give something over and you repeat it, a secret? What? Broken telephone, it's called? Yeah. I think it's called, it wasn't called ghosts. In my day, they might have been called ghosts. Whatever, it doesn't matter. But the point is, you say a secret, you say something over, you send it to the next time before you know it. By the time you get to the last thing, it's completely a different message. You know? But the Torah didn't work that way. The Torah doesn't work that way. The Torah, because of the fact that HaKadosh Baruch Hu said, every Jew has to give over this message, this fact, to all of their families in very, very, you know, strong statements of truth, that sent the message to everybody. This is the way it is. It's an amazing thing that a Seder, who doesn't have a Seder? Well, show me a Jew, Afghanistan to Bulgaria to America to Hungary, you name it. Jews have had Sedarim, had the Seder night for thousands of years. So it doesn't change. Maybe the menu changes, right? Maybe you'll have one thing, we'll have another thing. You guys will eat rice, we won't eat rice, whatever. But at the end of the day, it's a Seder. And this is an incredible testimony to the truth of the Torah. Vichmer ma'od b'inyin hazeh. And God was extremely strong. Why is Pesach so serious? Before you know it, Pesach is going to be here. It's coming up fast. Okay? He says, why is Pesach so serious? Why is a punishment so serious? K'mo shechayev kores b'achilas chametz. Why? You eat pizza on Pesach. What's a punishment? Death penalty. Pizza on Pesach? Bread on Pesach? U'bazivas a Pesach, if you don't offer the korban Pesach, that's also a kores. Very severe. And every single day, what happened, what transpired, is on our heads, it's on our arms, we're wearing it hopefully underneath our shirts. We won't take a tzitzis check right now, but we have it underneath our shirts, and we know, okay, every single day we're saying this because we need to know that this is what happened, and we're giving testimony to that. Okay, not only that, v'lichtav oso, to write it, od al pischei batim mezuzos, we have it on our doors, everywhere, every time. Now, again, life goes too fast. See, we have to slow things down. Because, you know, we're twilling back and forth, you know, whatever, you put it on, you take it off, you finish it, and you go, even, we kiss the mezuzah, it's almost like robotic. You know, I don't do that all the time. But even if we do sometimes, which is a beautiful thing to do, it's almost robotic. Because, what are you doing? What did you just do? What you just did, hello, is you kissed a parchment that represents a statement that HaKadosh Baruch Hu took us out of Mitzrayim and is still with us till today. So that kiss is not like, blah, 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 blah. No, it's an incredibly serious testimony to who we are as a people and that God is part of our lives. And if we stop and really think about what we do and the way we do it, we'd have a different perspective of the world. And that's why, so God wants us to be surrounded by this idea. And everywhere we go, to put it on our bodies, to put it on our doorposts. And to say it every single day, morning and night, right? We say the Shema aloud. Why do we say the Shema aloud? Because we have to articulate it. We have to think about it. It's an important statement. The Torah wants us to say every single day, morning and night. As the Gemara says in Brachos, this is a deraistic rule. Also, we say We say Shema. We make a sukkah every. Why do we make the sukkah every year? The sukkah also, because kibbutz sukkahs are shaftis bnei Yisrael. There is Mitzrayim. When we went out of Mitzrayim, b'tzeischem Mitzrayim, we sat in these huts or we had the ananiya covered. However you learn. So these are all. So it's all a system, right? We said kiddush. It's all the system of us having an ongoing relation with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So he says, and let's continue. He says something very dramatic here. He says, and we have many other mitzvahs like this. It's all about giving testimony that we should not forget who our God is, who we are as Jews. That there should not be an ability for a kofer to say, it's all baloney. It didn't happen. So what about us? I mean, we are living testimony. I know. Do we have people who say it didn't happen? We do. But they don't really have a very strong leg to stand on. Because how in the world, and this is really something that we speak about, I tell every once in a while, we try to bring it up at different discussions, that we are unique to every other religion. If anybody thinks that we're no different than any other religion, it's a total lie. Okay, and I think most of you know this. Every other religion starts with one guy. Okay, and there's no testimony, there's no Christian who can get together with his family at the table and say, our ancestors all saw God's divine revelation. Didn't happen. Okay. In fact, what's really interesting is that all the Christians admit that there was a Maimon Har Sinai. They don't deny the fact that we went out of Egypt. They just say that we messed up in the time of Yashka. We messed up and they took over. Okay, what do the Muslims say? We messed up, so the Muslims took over. Muhammad flew off the mountain, okay, got a little hashish in his system and, you know, flew off the mountain and he did some, who knows, whatever he did. Okay, with his white donkey over there. So, but it's one guy. We don't have 3 million people testifying to Muhammad's performing a miracle. Okay, first of all, even a miracle is that. But the Jewish people are the only religion that 3 million of us were in Maimon Har Sinai. The heavens open up. HaKadosh Baruch Hu said, Anochi Hashem Elokecha, and we give testimony every single year to that fact. No other religion. It's not even close. It's all about some disciples who, you know, Peter, Paul, and Mary gave it over to generations. And it's all like stories and fables. There's no testimony. There isn't an entire nation giving over to their children. This is what occurred. And they, all they can rely on, and the only problem with, I mean, the biggest question on Christianity and on Islam is, so wait a minute. You grant that God gave the Torah to the Jewish people. But if you ask any Muslim and every Christian, they will say, yeah, the Old Testament is true. We bind to the Old Testament. So I understand. So God gave the Torah to the Jewish people amongst 3 million, but when he canceled it and he said the deal is off, he only did that to one guy at night in a vision or in a dream. What sense does that make? If God wanted to break the deal, he should have gotten all of us together in Dodger Stadium, opened up and said, you know what, guys, you blew it. Jews, you blew it. That's it. Nah, I'm sorry. You know, you messed up. Never did that. So we're supposed to what? We're supposed to know that the deal's off. Chas v'shalom. The deal's not off. God said the deal's forever. And God said, I'll never break the deal with you. God said that when he gave us the Torah. This is a marriage we can't get divorced from. So it really, they don't have a leg to stand on. I hope this doesn't get into the wrong hands. I don't know. I might get into trouble. Anyway, okay. Yeah, it's being recorded. Okay, so, and look what he says here. Ki hakona mezuzah bezuzah echad. When a person buys a mezuzah, here he says, you buy it for a zuzah echad. In those days, the mezuzah was cheap. Now you got to spend 70, 80 bucks on a mezuzah. It's not so cheap anymore. Okay, but if a person buys a mezuzah for one zuz, the cover of a pischo, and he puts it on his door, the niskavim binyonov, and he's thinking, binyonov, and he thinks about what it's all about. Kfar hoda bechidu sha'olam, in that small action, okay? Asher kadi shalom mezuzah sivanu lekvar mezuzah. He nails that mezuzah in, and he's thinking about what he's doing in that small action. What he's really saying is, I know how we got here. I know God is in charge of the world. He is involved in this world, and he's actively in control of what's going on in this world. And I'm also testifying to the Navu of Moshe Benu, the Hemin Bechopinos the Torah. And he's saying that I also believe in all of the subtleties and all of the corners, all the pinos, the little subtle corners of the Torah. I believe in it all, because this mezuzah is testifying to that fact. It becomes so dramatic when you look at it in the Rabban's words. It's like every mitzvah we do could be so powerful. It's so sad that sometimes we're just so rushed, we just have no time, you know, boom, 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 we just, you know, in and out and chick-chack, it just goes like nothing. It's so sad. And in addition, that we're also saying that how kind HaKadosh Baruch Hu is, how he sustained us, and how he gives reward for those people who do the mitzvahs, and that he took us out. I mean, think about it. He took us out to freedom, and it's a great, great honor, okay, for us to do what he wants to the ancestors of the past. So when we do things, it doesn't just impact us, it impacts the people before us as well. Okay, ulufikach. Again, he's going to say some really, really wild things right now, so I just want to, in a few minutes we have left, let's see if we can finish this up. He says something really incredible. We're two paragraphs from the end of the page. Ulufikach amru. And therefore says the Ramban, therefore it says in Pirkei Avos, Havizor mitzvah kal b'chamura, be careful. The idea that you pick certain mitzvahs, you know, oh, this one I'm concerned about, that one I'm not so concerned about, you know, Lashon Hara, I'm not big on Lashon Hara, but I'm very big on kosher, I love eating on kosher, but you know, I'll speak Lashon Hara. No, there's no, the idea of choosing mitzvahs and picking, picking certain mitzvahs, and that's not an acceptable approach. Shekulon chamuros, chamudos v'chavivos mod. HaKadosh Baruch Hu loves every mitzvah. He doesn't have any favorites. He might give certain mitzvahs more punishment than other mitzvahs. He has no favorites. He has no mitzvahs that he loves more than the others. Shebechol shah, adamoda ben lelakav. Because every mitzvah you do, you're recognizing that HaKadosh Baruch Hu runs the world, and you're connecting to God. So we have 613 mitzvahs. We have 613 chances to connect to God in a very meaningful way. Look what he says. This is one of the most amazing statements you'll ever see. Maybe I'll ask you first, before we even read the Ramban. If I asked you, okay, what would be the reason why we have all the mitzvahs? Why did God give us 613 commandments? What's the reason why we have all these commandments?
To better us as a human.
Okay, that's a good logical answer. To better us as a human being.
Show
okay.
Devotion.
Show our devotion, okay. And probably you'd also say that by doing the mitzvahs, you get a lot of reward for the mitzvahs, and because Baruch Hu wanted to give us a lot of rewards. So the moments as we do, we should have reward. But at the end of the day, we look at the mitzvos as sort of separate entities of different things that we do for whatever reason that God gave us. Look at what the Ramban says. He says something mind-blowing. He says, what?
To just acknowledge that Hashem.
Okay, teaches knowledge, yes. All that is true. But look what he says. He really puts it... He makes it so succinct. Okay, that's a Krauss word, succinct. Right? You all know what that means? Okay, he makes it very focused and fine. Okay? V'kavonos kol mitzvos. Right? Oh, you don't have Krauss. Okay. V'kavonos kol mitzvos. Shenamin belokeinu. The purpose of all of the mitzvos is that we should believe in God. V'no de love shubarenu. Wild. At the end of the day, all of what you said is correct, but at the end of the day, says the Ramban, the reason we have all the mitzvos is that we should recognize God, know that He is in this world, and thank Him for creating us.
He
what?
He said that, to acknowledge that.
Oh, okay, perfect. Okay, fine. Okay, I thought you were saying that it gives us more knowledge of the way HaKadosh Baruch Hu, but yes, exactly. Vein kel elyon chafet petachtonim. And what God really wants at the end of the day, what does He really want from us? Right? At the end, give me the bottom line. What does God want from the human being? Milvad sheyeda ha'odom v'yodil kov shaboro. To truly, truly believe and internalize that God created us. Which means, Rabbi Yisrael, what this means is that it's obviously not so easy. If God gave us the entire Torah to recognize, to come to the recognition, that means that recognition is not so easy. Okay, so maybe there are no atheists in foxholes, but what happens very often in the course of life is that, you know, we forget, right? I love that cute little story about the guy who has a business meeting at 9 o'clock and it's 5 to 9. He's running around Olympic Boulevard there, around the building, waiting for, he needs a parking spot. He says, I can't be late for this meeting. It's my biggest chance. I need to have this meeting. She says, to God, please, God, if you give me a parking spot, I promise you I will never speak. And he's about to say Oshar again. And as he's saying that, a car opens up and a perfect spot right in front of the building. And he says, never mind, God, I found the spot. You know? So, what is that? This is how we... So, you believe, and then when it comes easy and everything's good, then, forget about it. No. So, God says, I want you to live your life constantly with the awareness that there's a God in the world. And that's why we get together to daven. Why is there such an emphasis on getting together in shul? Right? Why? And you guys... Baruch Hashem, do it beautifully. Okay, sometimes, we say a lot, the Ashkenazim should look to the Sfarim to see how to take davening seriously. But what makes davening so important? What is it about getting together and praying? Why is that? So everyone, a lot of kids think, a lot of adults think, it's about, this way I can pray for my new Xbox, for my... I